These crumbling buildings are all that's left of the Gager Lime Company in Sherwood, Tennessee. The crenellated towers and vine-covered buildings give the ruins the appearance of a medieval castle. Across town, ivy hides a sandstone wall and the remains of an old church. Vines and privet hedge hide stories from the past. Crumbling buildings and ivy-covered walls, however, are only part of the story.
Well, I guess the main thing is the people here. There's some real good people, and you know, it's just like everybody knows everybody, and you just feel like you could, you know, call on people if you need them.
I can't ever remember having a key to a door. Never. Ever remember a door being locked?
Yep. Never needed one.
Nope.
Roots are deep here. Roots are real deep, and that's why I'm still here. And that's why I come to this, and I'm sure that's why all these other people that's here today come. It's a kind of a dormant place at times, and when, if you're just driving through and ain't nothing going on, but when we do have something, it comes alive with people. People really support everything we do here.
I just love working here. I love the people, being around them. They're real. These are real people. And, you know, if they love you, they love you. If they hate you, they hate you, but they'll tell you. You know, there's no backstabbing going on. If they're going to stick you, they'll look you right in the eye. But these are real people.
You know, Chicago, New York, that's too many people for a country boy like myself. Like I said, I've traveled around some on construction and moved around a good bit, not moved, but staying in motels and all that stuff, working different jobs, and there's nothing like coming back to Sherwood. But Sherwood is... I could find anything better, I would be there.
I don't know. I think it's the people, and it's just the atmosphere. I don't know. It's different here. It's not run, rush, go. It's slow. I think that's got a lot to do with it. You can take your time. You know what you... I don't know. I don't really know, but it's just a very peaceful thing to me.
At one time, Sherwood was a busy place. Now the last store in town is closed. The closest gas station is 30 minutes away. The Lime Company has been closed for more than 60 years. The post office is still open. There's a volunteer fire station. And three churches. And there's some new jobs at the old quarry. Several families still live here, but many more have moved away. The town of Sherwood came into being in 1878, just 13 years after the end of the Civil War. White settlers began moving here more than 200 years ago. Several thousand years have passed since the first people came here, but even that is the blink of an eye. The rocks that form the valley, they go back a long, long way to a time before people, a time even before dinosaurs.
If you could have gone back at this time period, roughly 330, 340 million years ago, this entire area was underwater, and it would have looked like the Bahamas. This would have been just this enormous, beautiful reef area back at this time period, 340 million years ago or so. And as the waves crash up and they bash the reef and they break up pieces of the reef, you end up with these little bitty particles that are sand-sized or smaller that are made of calcium carbonate. And they ultimately will get deposited all around the reef and all on the sea floor to turn it into, you know, the limestone that you've got here. I don't know of any other place, you know, in the Monteagle limestone that's so pure, and so it really is kind of unusual.
A very solid piece of evidence that ancient sea animals built these high limestone walls is a large piece of coral found atop the old Gager quarry. It was found by Terry Pack of Sherwood Mining and donated to the Department of Forestry and Geology at the University of the South.
One of the things that's really cool about this sample is that I've never seen any of the colonial corals in this area. And this is exactly what we see today in modern day corals. I brought a couple of samples from some corals that are from a reef just off the coast of Mexico. And you can see exactly the same things in them, except that these are very recent. And this guy here dates back to about 330, 340 million years ago.
If those 340 million years were compressed into a century, it would have been about 2 days ago when the first people came to the valley. And the pilgrims on the Mayflower, well, they got here about an hour ago.
We know that people were here at least 12,000 years ago. And so they would have been foragers, hunter-gatherers, highly mobile, carrying everything they needed. They probably had dogs, but they had no other domestic plants or animals. We have some of the earliest and the largest number of what we call Paleo-Indian sites that are actually just south of Sherwood and in the region of Crow Creek as it hits into northern Alabama. There are more Paleo-Indian sites there in two counties than the entire state of South Carolina. We're all very interested in preserving our history of Euro-Americans coming in and starting industry in Sherwood, but that the Native American history is also very important, and it's extremely fragile, and that it is not just my history, your history, it is our history.
When Tennessee became a state in 1796, the lands south of the Duck River were still claimed by Native Americans. Franklin County was formed in 1807, but at that time the Crow Creek Valley was still claimed by the Cherokee. Despite the claims of the Cherokee, white settlers began moving into the valley. One of the earliest was George Gray, said to have settled in the valley in 1809.
An old lady by the name of Lundy, and member of Gray's family, was ill and in bed on an occasion when a party of Indians approached with evil designs. The family, seeing the Redskins approaching, fled into the mountains, leaving Mrs. Lundy in the house. The Indians carried all the goods out of the house, placed the invalid lady on a bed a safe distance from the house, then burned the house, cut down the corn, and fled without doing further damage.
When Marion County was laid out in 1817, the South Cumberland Plateau, including the Crow Creek Valley, was part of the new county. People in the valley were not happy with the arrangement, however, and 115 residents of Crow Creek petitioned the legislature to be included in Franklin County. In November 1825, the state legislature granted their petition, and Crow Creek began its stepchild relationship with Franklin County. While the petitioners were concerned with the problem of getting to and from the county seat, a transportation revolution was unfolding in England. In 1825, George Stephenson built the first public steam railway in the world. The first commercial railroad in the United States was completed in South Carolina in 1833. When business leaders in Tennessee learned of South Carolina's success, they pressed the legislature to support construction of a Nashville to Chattanooga railroad.
Now, the Nashville Chattanooga Railroad was chartered by the state of Tennessee in 1846. by a gentleman named Vernon K. Stevenson, who was a proponent of transport using rail rather than trying to rely on the roads that were pretty much non-existent in those days, mainly pathways and wagon ways and river. So Mr. Stevenson and a number of other people, a fellow by the name of John Edgar Thompson. Mr. Thompson surveyed down through here and up through Mont Eagle and a number of other places, and they decided that this place in the mountain, just up the tracks here from this depot, in a sag in the mountain called Montgomery Gap. Montgomery Gap was a low point in the mountain between this valley and the Crow Creek Valley. It's a pretty important place. Now, Sherwood was the other side of it. It's an 8.5 mile section of track between Cowan and Sherwood. The tunnel was dug basically by hand using the most primitive of tools through mostly solid limestone, so it proved to be an excellent choice. The Civil War was the first war fought using railroads for transport. And so when Sherman came to this area and Nashville fell, it wasn't long before Sherman put his sights on Chattanooga and Atlanta. And here was this wonderful railroad that had been here for going on 9 or 10 years at this point. Perfect place to allow them to transport their goods through here. It could have changed the entire war if the tunnel had been blocked. But here's the thing. We only had black powder in those days. It took them 4 years to dig it with black powder. They're not going to blow it up in one try with black powder. But still, you got to try. They would have retreated through the tunnel and brought up a train or something with them loaded with black powder and set it off somewhere in or near the tunnel to try to collapse it. I understand that's what they did, but of course it didn't work. Too much mountain, not enough explosive. Pretty simple, actually.
V.K. Stevenson had hoped the Nashville-Chattanooga Railroad would bring prosperity to the region, but for a while, it was an instrument of war. People in the Crow Creek Valley witnessed the comings and goings of two huge armies. The railroad took young men away to be soldiers, and it brought them home to die. John Jordan Alexander was wounded at the Battle of Stones River.
He was being taken to a hospital on a train. The train stopped at Tantallon to take on water. When John realized he was near his home, he rolled out of the boxcar as the train left. His uncle, Champ Gwynn, who lived in nearby Pump Log Hollow, took him to his home. The only medical attention that John received was to put a piece of silk scarf in the slot of a steel ramrod and pull it through the bullet wound in John's chest. Blood poisoning set up, but he survived for about 4 days. All of his relatives saw him before he died. John was buried somewhere at the mouth of Pump Log Hollow.
Families on both sides of the conflict felt the same grief at the loss of a family member. But at the end of the war, Southerners were left with the additional burden of near total devastation. Agriculture and industry were left in ruins. Southern businessmen who had depended on free labor from an enslaved population of African Americans faced a critical labor shortage. The South needed investors, industry, and labor. Victory had left the Northerners certain of their cause and of the nation's manifest destiny. As soldiers, they had seen the potential wealth of the South, and after the war, many wanted to take advantage of that opportunity. Men who had been blood enemies for 4 years soon found a grudging mutual interest in developing the South. Tennessee and other southern states began efforts to encourage people to move to the South. Among those leading the effort to bring settlers and investment to Tennessee was Joseph Killebrew, Commissioner of Agriculture and Immigration. His first project was publication of a 1,200-page description of the resources of Tennessee. In it, Killebrew listed the agricultural and industrial possibilities of each county.
The Cumberland Tablelands, having all the advantages of early summer climate, makes it the country for orchards, vineyards, and gardens. Last but not least, its cool summer nights, its cold gushing fountains, and its life-giving chalybeate springs, and its invigorating atmosphere render it attractive during the hot months, and it bids fair in a few years to be the favorite resort of Southern men.
One of those who apparently heard Killebrew's invitation was Charles Sherwood. He'd come to Minnesota from Connecticut in 1857, and he spent the next 20 years involved in Minnesota public affairs and politics. He was lieutenant governor of the state during the Civil War. Although he registered for the draft in 1863, there's no indication he served in the Union Army. As a member of the state legislature, he helped bring railroads to the wilds of Minnesota, and his pioneer spirit, combined with a restless nature, brought him to the South. On April 15, 1878, the state legislature granted Sherwood a charter for the Tennessee Immigration and Land Company. The same day, Sherwood purchased more than 1,400 acres from John F. Anderson, one of the wealthiest men in the valley. And there was even a town named for Anderson, near the railroad, on the banks of Crow Creek, a stone's throw from the Alabama state line. Another stop along the railroad included Tantallon, a watering place for steam locomotives. Nearby Pump Log Hollow got its name from the drilled-out cedar logs.
Pump Log Spring, where the trains got the water when they first put the railroad through here. They piped it from that spring up there across the creek in cedar logs. Now, how they got that hole through them cedar logs, I don't know. But it was in cedar logs, and they were banded together with steel band, and they got their water over there. So that's why this is called Pump Log Holler.
Midway between Anderson and Tantallon, or Tantaller, as some of the old-timers called it, was Ketching Station, named for station master Meredith Ketchings. Sometimes it was referred to as Kitchens Station, but Ketchings was the name used on the railroad schedule. No doubt, some members of the Ketchings family were very upset when they learned what Charles Sherwood had in mind. In its early days, the new town of Sherwood was often referred to as the Sherwood Colony, and the word colony meant just that.
The question is often asked, how will the people of Tennessee receive northern men and women as kindly as they deserve? If they come to stir up strife between the races, they will not and should not be respected. It is also asked whether it would be best for immigrants to come singly or in groups or colonies. Experience has shown that they are better satisfied when they have the companionship of some of their old friends and neighbors.
One of the Sherwood colonists was Oliver F. Brand, a farmer and also a Union veteran who had seen the valley in the spring of 1862 during an expeditionary march toward Chattanooga. He moved south in 1883.
While grinding corn that fall, Governor Charles D. Sherwood came to see me, his object being to persuade me to move to Sherwood, Tennessee. He claimed, on the authority of the Agricultural Department at Washington, that the district was the center of the best sorghum belt in the United States and wanted me to move my mill and all the machinery there. His argument persuaded me, largely because my wife was in poor health and I thought the climate might benefit her. And so it did. Sherwood stayed overnight with us, and C.F. Miller came to see us. He also became imbued with the Southern fever.
Unfortunately, Oliver Brand's visit to Sherwood was a serious disappointment. The winter of 1883-84 was rainy, but the next summer, drought nearly ruined his sorghum crop. A young daughter was born in June and died after only 8 days. Legal problems added to his headaches, and he finally decided to throw in the towel.
About Christmas time, that is 1884, a party of mountaineers came to our place armed with guns, which they fired off to frighten us while they were stealing our chickens. Shortly after that, we moved 2 miles north, where I left the family while I went to McMinnville. We moved there the following February.
Although Brand was disappointed with his stay in Sherwood, another contemporary report painted a glowing picture of the new town.
The colony consists at present of 30 northern and 10 southern families, and the town has 2 general stores, a steam saw planing and shingle mill combined, 2 churches, the Sherwood Academy, and 1 free school, the railroad depot and offices, a large number of dwellings, and some mechanical shops.
Another colonist, George Hannum, was principal of the Sherwood Academy. A native of Massachusetts, he had moved to Minnesota after the Civil War. He and his wife Amelia came to Sherwood in 1883. The Sherwood Academy was one of more than 500 schools and colleges established after the war by the American Missionary Association, initially to assist newly freed African Americans. By the 1880s, however, the association had expanded its mission to include a group of people described as Poor Mountain Whites. Just how much the Poor Mountain Whites in Crow Creek needed the assistance of the AMA is uncertain, but Oliver Brand had a low opinion of his neighbors.
Aside from ourselves, a few northern families at Sherwood, one family of cultured southerners, the Bledsoes, and one lone black man, the sole tenants of the valley were crackers or mountaineers.
Brand's biased view of the local people was typical of the harsh and unflattering stereotypes held by some in the North and East. Even the AMA, which had come to assist the Poor Mountain Whites, sometimes published unsympathetic articles about the people they'd come to help.
These people are not really poor. Most of them own farms of 300 or 400 acres. The women and the children, of course, do most of the hard work in the hot sun, while the lord of the home saddles his horse and rides to town to sit on store boxes and tell slow stories. These people, especially the male portion, seem to have a natural distaste for labor. They are bigoted and ignorant. Unless these people have help, they will prove a fretting leprosy in our nation.
Charles Sherwood was more interested in real estate than missionary work. He had dreamed of building a thriving colonial economy based on tourism and industry. But after more than 10 years, the town had not lived up to his vision. Oliver Brand had stayed just over a year before leaving in 1885. Sherwood's son, Elmer, became part owner of the town's largest store. Sadly, however, Elmer died in December 1889, leaving a widow and 2 small children. More bad news came in 1891. Stanley Lathrop, the AMA minister, left the colony in the summer, and the AMA gave up operation of the Sherwood Academy in December. The town was faced with an uncertain future, and it might have suffered the same fate as a colony in neighboring Coffee County. Today, little remains of the Lowell colony from Lowell, Massachusetts, except a short gravel road northwest of Manchester. In 1891, the Sherwood colony seemed destined for that same fate. But 600 miles away, near Sandusky, Ohio, events were unfolding that would turn things around. In 1891, the Kelly, Lime, and Transport began buying railroads and lime manufacturing companies around Marblehead, Ohio. One of the companies was Gager and Gamble, partly owned by Byron Gager. With cash in hand, he decided to build a new lime processing plant, but it had to be near a source of high-grade limestone. His search for the mineral brought him to Tennessee.
Byron Gager was as persistent as he was thorough, and many weary miles he traveled over the mountains between Winchester and Chattanooga, inspecting quarries and examining stones. And one would naturally ask now, how on earth did he miss the quarry at Sherwood? The fact is, there was no quarry at Sherwood. A little lime kiln operated occasionally there, feeding on boulders lying loose on the mountainside. But this stone and its possibilities of a quarry there were little known. It was only by chance that Mr. Gager learned from an old man in Winchester of this great deposit of limestone.
Gager Lime and Manufacturing was exactly the type of industry Tennessee business and political leaders were looking for as they sought to build a new South from the ashes of the Civil War. The company was chartered 3 days before Christmas in 1892, and it must have been a great present for Charles Sherwood, his family, and his town. Sherwood was able to sell 1,600 acres of land to Byron Gager in return for $1,500 cash and shares of Gager stock worth $3,000. In addition, he was listed as one of the five partners in the Gager Charter. There's no way to know for sure what would have happened if Byron Gager had not met the old man in Winchester who told him about the limestone ore. But thanks to his persistence, the Sherwood Colony not only survived, it prospered. Unfortunately, Charles Sherwood wasn't able to enjoy the prosperity for very long. Governor Sherwood, as the locals called him, turned 60 in 1893. Age had begun to catch up with him. In 1895, he took a train to Chicago to have surgery to repair a hernia. Sherwood never returned to Tennessee. On July 3, 1895, newspapers reported that his body had been found in Lake Michigan.
It was undoubtedly a suicide. For the last 6 weeks, Mr. Sherwood had been confined to his room most of the time. His only companion was John Van Alstyne, the old porter at the hotel. "I am satisfied that Mr. Sherwood committed suicide," said the old porter at the Victor Hotel tonight. "He had been in poor health for the last 5 years, and although he never mentioned it to me that he would kill himself, I knew he was despondent over business reverses. He was in arrears for his room when he died."
Sherwood's financial problems were bigger than a delinquent hotel bill, however. 2 weeks after the suicide, the St. Paul Daily Globe reported that $700 entrusted to Sherwood could not be accounted for, and that he had taken $17,000 from investors through a phony mortgage scheme. In today's money, that total would be the equivalent of more than $480,000. The national economy, crippled by depression from 1893 through 1897, may have contributed to Charles Sherwood's desperate financial situation. During that period, tense labor relations in Tennessee's coal mining regions, including neighboring Grundy County, erupted into several violent confrontations. Against the grim backdrop of depression and labor disputes, however, Byron Gager managed to create a thriving company that would be the community's economic foundation for more than 60 years. Gager's success did not go unnoticed. In September 1895, Oliver N. Alden invested $1,600 in a lime production facility directly across the valley from Gager. Alden, a descendant of Mayflower pilgrim John Alden, located his limestone quarry at the 950-foot level, the same as the Gager quarry, possibly to access the same type of high-grade limestone as his competitor. Alden built a small gauge inclined railway which ran down the mountain, across the creek, and ended at the railroad tracks just north of the depot. He was operating with the odds stacked against him, however. The entire nation, of course, was in the grip of economic depression, and Alden was 18 years older than Gager. He was a farmer without extensive background in the lime industry. It's possible that he might have succeeded and the town would have had two lime companies, but he died on December 3, 1895, just 3 months after starting his operation. His two sons tried, but were not able to make the Alden Lime Company a success. By the 1920s, Gager was being called the largest and most complete lime plant in the South. From two kilns, in 1893, the company had expanded to 16 vertical kilns and two large rotary kilns. The company celebrated its success in 1925 with a big 4th of July celebration. The train brought ice from Winchester to cool lemonade and make ice cream. The company also celebrated success by erecting new buildings fashioned after English castles from the days of Robin Hood. There were also new towers modeled on the ancient Egyptian columns at the Temple of Karnak. Gager's output in its last four decades of operation averaged 45% of all the lime produced in the state of Tennessee. A rising tide lifts all ships, and so it was in Sherwood. During the first decade of Gager's operation, the population in Crow Creek increased by 10%. It rose another 16% in the decade from 1900 to 1910. One of the Sherwood institutions lifted by that rising tide was the Episcopal Mission. It was started by Archdeacon W.S. Claiborne, who held the first service in Sherwood on Christmas Day, 1898. Epiphany Mission picked up where the Congregationalist missionaries had left off at their departure 7 years earlier. Its goal, to help the poor, the sick, and children. Although Claiborne is credited with founding the church, by his own admission, much of the day-to-day work was done by women.
The congregation has grown in spite of a lack of help, and we have an excellent mission. In charge of a woman who is teacher of the children and a moral force in the community, and who has had practically to carry it alone.
That industrious woman was Clementine Rowe. A native of Ireland, she lived and worked in Sherwood for several years. Kate Lappin lives on the spot where Epiphany Mission constructed its first church building. The land was next to the old school where Claiborne conducted his first Mass in 1898.
Mr. Bill Smith said that the front part of this house was the old church house. Mm-hmm. But he said they moved it off the bank back there in the back and turned it around.
F.W. Webster donated the quarter acre of land to the church. Webster, a Union veteran from Wisconsin, had built the first limestone kiln in Sherwood near the site for the church. As the town grew, the congregation of Epiphany Mission also grew, and in 1927, the church began a more substantial sandstone building near the bridge across Crow Creek. A photograph of the new building was among many featured on the front page of the June 27, 1929 edition of the county paper. There was also a photograph of the new school. In fact, much of the paper was devoted to showcasing the forgotten corner of Franklin County. 100 years after petitioning the legislature to become part of Franklin County instead of Marion County, the valley was about to get a new road to Suwannee.
No road project, no improvement of any description has done as much toward the advancement of any community as the building of the Sherwood Pike has done for Franklin County. Without the road, that section of the county might just as well have been a section of Alabama, for 9/10 of the banking and trading of the Crow Creek Valley people outside their own community was done in Stevenson, Alabama.
A front page article praised Gager's finishing line as far superior to any yet manufactured in the United States. Production in 1929 was higher than it had ever been. The town's future seemed more promising than ever before. 4 months later, however, the nation entered a depression that was even worse than that of 1893. By 1933, the national economy was at a standstill. Gager's production that year was less than a third of what it had been in 1929. Layoffs at the lime plant devastated the town's economy. Those who managed to keep a job worked fewer hours, sharing their meager salary with family and friends.
They worked one day a week, maybe, and that's all they got. And most of them didn't, 2 days a week is all they got. And you had to have a garden, pick blackberries, put all that stuff up in your garden, kill three or four hogs. Some of them couldn't even afford the money to buy a hog and raise it. But most people done that over there. That's how they got through the Depression. Because my dad just worked 2 days a week at the plant. And he could work three, but he worked two and let another man that wasn't going to get to work. Only one man over there wouldn't transfer that out. He worked the 3 days. Boy, they let him know it too when he got the union in.
But, you know, after the Depression, everybody had it pretty rough down there. Gage and Lime Company, they didn't have no work for all the people. And they give, you know, just what they could to each person where they could have a little income. Well, I can remember going down to the commissary and getting a script. It was just a piece of paper and taking it to Walter Lynch's. And back then, they used chips instead of money, old chips. Well, it was for a dollar. That's all it lets you draw out. And the way we bought groceries back then, dimes worth at a time, 15 cents worth.
Whether it was divine intervention, fate, or just good luck, Father George W. Jones came to Epiphany Mission in 1932, one of the worst years of the Depression.
He came there in a rough time, in the 30s. And he was told by the Diocese of Tennessee that they would not support him because it wasn't worth going to. Now, he told me this himself. And he says, I told him I didn't need their support. So he stayed from house to house. I think he stayed some with the Lynches and some with the Robinsons. He had to go from house to house because there was nowhere else to go, see. And he was just a deacon. And Father Fly tutored him in the rest of it to become a priest.
Born to a life of privilege on a plantation near Savannah, Georgia, Jones had a talent for attracting money and gifts to the mission. His primary tool was a quarterly pamphlet from Epiphany simply called The Booklet.
But he got that idea that he had to have some money. So he sent out, I believe he told me he sent out 25 or 30 letters to people he knew in Georgia and places like that and everything. And told them to send what they could and to send their letter to somebody else they knew that might want to help support us. Mm-hmm. That's where the greater congregation growed. And when I left there, it was 3,000.
For 20 years, he asked for and received gifts of money and clothing, which he distributed to more than half of Sherwood's population.
Well, back then, if we got a good Christmas present, it was from the church. And so that's where all of our clothes come from. If we needed some clothes, they would get our sizes and send their names off to different people. And sometimes we'd get a brand new pair of shoes and a pair of pants.
In addition to attracting money, food, and clothing to the mission, the booklets also included many photographs of the town and the people. The booklets also contain Father Jones' detailed accounts of daily life in the valley.
Atop a mountain some 10 miles from Sherwood, there's a CCC camp. The mission girls, sometime either fondly in love with the boys, or at least charmed and fascinated, have now and again been kept up too late on Saturday nights and failed to hear the Sunday Mass for the first time in years. Moreover, two mission girls have married those CCC boys, with the mission thoroughly disapproving because of their tender age.
While the mission priest used the booklets to comment on morality and religion, he didn't hesitate to share his opinions on more secular matters. In the fall of 1937, he sharply criticized the union workers at the lime plant.
The plant has been a great blessing to the townspeople, and the people would probably be gratefully content, but for extraneous agitation. If the plant, which is the goose that lays the golden eggs, remains closed, this will be a winter of the greatest destitution Sherwood has known. Little children will suffer.
Some of the so-called extraneous agitation had originated in another institution whose goal was also to help local families suffering through the Depression. Miles Horton co-founded the Highlander Folk School near Mont Eagle in 1932, coincidentally the same year that Father Jones began his ministry at Epiphany Mission. Highlander's approach to alleviating poverty was to focus on civil rights and labor rights. Several Gager employees attended workshops in labor organization at Highlander. One of them was J.D. Bradford. The death of his father had forced him to quit school at the age of 15 and go to work at the limestone quarry. He and other dissatisfied workers formed Gager's first union in 1933. Although there was tension between union and Gager management, it was nothing compared to other areas of the state. A labor dispute in South Pittsburgh led to a gunfight on Christmas night in 1927, which killed the police chief, the county sheriff, and four others. A 1932 coal miners' strike in Wilder, Tennessee, turned violent. Railroad bridges were blown up, and Governor Henry Horton sent in the National Guard. Union leader Barney Graham was gunned down in Wilder. Graham became a martyr for the Union cause. His murder was dramatized in a pro-Union documentary, People of the Cumberland. The 1938 film, produced with the assistance of Highlander Folk School, also included scenes of Union workers at Gager Lime. Things got a bit wild and woolly in Sherwood when the film's cinematographer, Ralph Steiner, brought his crew to film on Gager property.
I remember once we were shooting some lime workers and we were chased off the plant grounds. They came after us with guns. The whole town was owned by the plant, so we had to shoot the union meeting on the road, right in the middle of the road, because that belonged to the county and not the company.
Opinion in Sherwood is still divided as to whether the demise of the lime plant was caused by the union or by management.
My daddy was a keel foreman at the Gager Lime Company. See, he left as soon as plant shut down in 49. Well, I was born in 41, so I was just 8 years old, and then he had to leave and go off and work. Daddy used to say, you know, when he'd come in on weekends, and of course, of us kids running around, and he'd say, when he'd have to leave, you know, a lot of times he'd get to talking about the union running. He said, well, kids, I wouldn't have to go so far and wouldn't be gone all week if the union hadn't come in. You know, I mean, that was kind of, he had a bitter taste in his mouth about the way they came in and done. But at that time, I didn't even know nothing about unions, you know, but I knew that he talked about it.
Okay, my father's name was George Uding. He was in the building business for a number of years, and then he went to work for Mississippi Lime. He worked there until we moved to Tennessee, I think in 1941. At Gager, he had the title of master mechanic. I don't think they use that term much anymore, but it was really maintenance superintendent. He supervised all of the plant maintenance. But I remember him he would say that Gager was doing good business during the war, but they were having some kind of quality problems back then. And my dad had spoken of this some time. He felt that they were not burning the lime right, and I don't know what that means. But he was, at times, had become agitated. They're going to ruin this plant. They're not burning the lime right. Then sometime, it was several years perhaps, I can remember when it happened or after it happened, we got word that Gager Lime had shut down. And it was kind of a sad day for us because we were affiliated with Gager through the war years. I don't know if it was because of this quality problem he spoke of or other reasons.
The failure of Gager Lime was the result of a number of circumstances which, in hindsight, might have been remedied. But after the death of founder Byron Gager in 1926, the company had no one to provide the same vision and drive. The company's reputation had been built on a product that was no longer needed. Gager had come to Sherwood because of the high calcium oolitic limestone used to make plaster. Plastering walls was a time-consuming process requiring skilled workers. The growing acceptance of sheetrock during World War II made that process obsolete. High-grade limestone was still essential in many industrial and chemical processes, but greater demand also required increasingly larger factories. As other companies expanded and grew larger, Gager stayed the same. The company struggled on for a few years after World War II, but in 1949, the company finally closed. Was it the fault of the union? Or was management to blame? For the fathers needing jobs, for a community in economic freefall, the reasons for closing were irrelevant.
The lime plant closed 2-3 years ago. Men of 40, 50, 60 years who had never worked elsewhere and who would have worked 30 or 20 or 10 years longer in the lime plant have found it most difficult and often impossible to find employment elsewhere. In 1951, many mission communicants moved away, many entire families, and a greater number of individuals left. A number of men still live in Sherwood with their families who are employed 25 or 75 or even more miles away. A greater number live in Sherwood who are not now employed at all.
Father Jones always said, the church is really not the building. Literally, it's the people. The church, I mean, the people are the church. So if wherever the people were affected, the church was affected too.
Well, they say when Gager shut down, that was what I have heard my daddy say, that a lot of people couldn't make it. You know, they didn't have nothing to eat. And if somebody came along and said, you know, if you move over here and you can farm, you can move over here and do something where you can feed your kids, well, they was up and gone. If they could find somebody to help them get gone, you know. But daddy didn't ever want to leave from here. Daddy wasn't going nowhere.
Well, they didn't know, I mean, they didn't have anywhere to go. The majority of the workers at the lime plant, the
office workers, they moved the office to Chattanooga before the plant park closed. And the plant didn't just close it. It just fizzled, I guess.
When Gager went down, closed, that would have been in 49. In 56, when we moved Sherwood, it was surprising that the people that was gone, they had been leaving for 10 years or longer.
For a long time, maybe as long as 5 years, they kept up hope that it would start back again. And every time a strange load of people came in, if they ventured down towards the lime plant, they'd think it was going to start up again.
Even though the town's only industry was on its last legs, Sherwood citizens remained upbeat. A gymnasium was built by the mission in 1948, and a new building for Flossie Bishop's used clothing store was also constructed next door. On September 14, 1950, the new gymnasium was the scene of what was undoubtedly the grandest celebration in the town's history. 10 years earlier, when England stood alone against Adolf Hitler's military, the United States loaned 50 World War I-era naval destroyers to the embattled nation. Among them was the USS Rogers, rechristened by the British Navy to HMS Sherwood. Many of the old ships were scrapped at the end of the war, and the British government, as a symbol of gratitude, presented 43 American communities with the bells, badges, and logbooks from the lend-lease ships. Hundreds of people packed the gym and the parking lot on a hot, muggy afternoon in September to witness Consul General McDermott present the ship's mementos to Father George W. Jones. Dr. Boylston Green, Vice Chancellor of the University of the South, was the master of ceremonies. Governor Gordon Browning spoke to the gathering and urged America and Great Britain to stand together against Russian imperialism. Tennessee's World War I hero, Alvin C. York, was also there to address the crowd. Hope rose and fell many times during the decade of the 1950s. For those who knew and loved the mission priest, hope would have been especially hard to maintain in May of 1952.
I called Duff Creason. He was still living there. So they called over to Father Huss, and Father Huss rung the bell. We had it agreed that if he died at night, the bell would be rung. So they rung the bell. That's the way we handled it then. Then, of course, he was buried in Sherwood because he felt for Sherwood. That's what he felt for. Yeah. And before he died, he made me promise to go over there and see the people. You had to see people that had the thing. He said, I want to be buried up there with the poor people, right in the center of the cemetery, and stay here. I don't want to go back to Georgia. This is my home, this is where I want to stay.
Father Joseph Husk succeeded Father Jones as mission priest. He was a teacher at St. Andrew's School for Boys in Sewanee before coming to Sherwood in 1952. One of his first tasks was to compile all the booklets from 1932 until 1952 into a single volume titled Candles in the Dark Boreen. It was published in 1954, a year of many ups and downs for Sherwood. In February, a new medical clinic was dedicated in memory of Father Jones. It contained a sitting room, examination room, two wards, and an emergency room. All it lacked was a doctor. The Franklin County Board of Education approved a motion for a new four-year high school at Sherwood in March of 1954. Pending approval from the state board, and adequate funding, the plans called for consolidation of the Sherwood, Sinking Cove, and Anderson schools. The mission agreed to turn over the gymnasium to the board when the new building was completed. Plans fell through, however, and high school students from Sherwood had to continue their daily 25-mile bus ride across the mountain. In July of 1954, the old wooden school building south of town burned, and Father Husk oversaw the construction of 6 classrooms on the west side of the gymnasium. Another fire in August 1954 burned the vacant offices of Gager Lime, but there was still a great deal of hope that better days were just around the corner. A week before the Gager fire, the county paper announced that Dylan Green of Chattanooga had tentatively agreed to purchase the Gager property for $67,000. 6 weeks later, however, the paper announced that the plans were on hold. Hopes skyrocketed in January of 1955 when it was announced that the deal was on again. A year after the announcement, Father Husk was still not convinced by such a magnitude of planning and wasn't willing to wait patiently. Calling on investors in Chattanooga, he organized the Epiphany Corporation to build a 13,000 square foot shirt factory, which was to create 180 new jobs. By the summer of 1956, the mission was in the process of training women to produce men's sports shirts. The clinic, which had been dedicated more than 3 years earlier, still had no full-time doctor or nurse, so it was repurposed as a training space. Plans for the factory were scaled back to 7,500 square feet, and the production of shirts didn't go well. By Christmas 1958, the shirt factory's future was in doubt. In the summer of 1959, 10 years after losing the Lime Company, Sherwood was forced to accept another disappointing loss. A decade of planning and hoping in Sherwood was left with nothing to plan for and very little hope. By 1960, there were 40% fewer people living in Sherwood than had lived there in 1930. What little hope there was for the congregation at Epiphany Mission was further eroded on Wednesday after Easter in 1960. Around 7 o'clock in the morning, black smoke was seen billowing from the roof and eaves of the church. The roof collapsed, and the large bell called St. Gabriel crashed to the ground in a shower of sparks. An hour later, only a part of the sandstone walls were still standing. Today, there's a volunteer fire department, but in 1960, people could only stand and watch their church burn to the ground. For 20 years, fire consumed one building after another in Sherwood, until only the post office and a gas station were left standing. In some ways, the decade of the 1960s marked the low point in Sherwood's history. At the beginning of the decade, one out of every 5 families in the United States were living in poverty. The economic situation in Sherwood was so severe that it attracted national attention. In December 1965, the Saturday Evening Post ran a 5-page article praising Father Husk's effort to help the town's poor. The article also featured the new church being constructed to replace the building that had burned 5 years earlier. A number of people in Sherwood, however, were not impressed with the imposing new structure.
"This is a great church here, this marvelous structure. I'll bet there's more than $500,000 poured into it. And who for? Not for us. Not for the folks of Sherwood. I don't know. Sometimes I think Father Husk is putting up a memorial to himself."
In late spring 1967, the new church was complete, except for a few finishing touches, but Father Husk was physically and mentally exhausted. Bishop John Vandross dissolved the priest-pastoral relationship with Epiphany Mission and directed him to take an indefinite leave of absence. Despite the poverty and dwindling population, the doors of Epiphany Mission are still open, as are those of the Church of Christ and the Emmanuel Apostolic Church. The churches reflect an enduring spirit of hope and resilience among Sherwood's remaining citizens. It's a trait that seems especially ingrained among women in the valley. Some of the names are known only to their kin, but they've been determined to do whatever it took to hold together family and church. In the 1940s, Ann Lynch, wife of lawman Nash Lynch, held church services in her home. Through her example and inspiration, the congregation built the Holiness Church, and now called the Emmanuel Apostolic Church. A tradition of strong leadership from women in the church continues today. In the early days of the Church of Christ, across the street, women helped maintain the church and held Sunday school on those weekends when no minister was available to preach. Sister Lucy Shedders of Sherwood holds the distinction of being the first woman to be ordained as an Episcopal priest in Tennessee. For several years, she traveled from St. Mary's in Sewanee to say Mass at Epiphany. Florence Huffer came to Sherwood in 1922 to teach school. A bout with tuberculosis resulted in her retirement in 1953, but after her recovery, she continued to serve her adopted community through the mission. She was honored by the church in 1972. Miss Florence was just one of many who taught Sherwood's children. There were schools in the community for more than 100 years, beginning with Sherwood Academy, established by George Hannum and his wife Amelia in 1883. Lois Cunningham, Miss Lois, to her students, taught the last generation of students who attended school in Sherwood. She began her education in a one-room schoolhouse in Sinking Cove. Going beyond the eighth grade seemed nearly impossible to her.
Well, they had built a new high school over at Winchester. He'd been there 1 year. And it was a brand new school, and it was so big I couldn't find my rooms. I was just about to cry when I got there and saw that school had been going on. I was a month behind, but I made it. But it was rough.
Miss Lois continued her education and earned both a bachelor's and master's degree from Middle Tennessee State. In the fall of 1960, she began teaching at her old school in Sinking Cove. And when that school closed in 1962, she was invited to teach at the new building in Sherwood. Although it lacked some conveniences, she taught there until the school closed in 1989.
We didn't have any air conditioners. It was most miserable by the time before 3 o'clock come, especially over next to the highway, that side. We didn't have any cold water. We just had a fountain. But the kids was glad to get a drink, that well water. They didn't ever say, well, I'd like to have an ice drink. No. They never did say anything about that. They didn't say anything about what our playground looked like. They just went out and played.
The building where Miss Lois and many others taught is now the Crow Creek Community Center. The center and the three churches are the bedrock of the town. These are the places where people come to renew their spirit, to renew their connection with each other and the past. It may be hard for outsiders to understand why people choose to live in a town without a grocery store or a gas station, why people still go to the same churches and eagerly attend the same community functions.
This community, it holds a special place in my heart. Raised here, and you know, I've seen a lot of our relatives and friends die off of the community, but you know, they've left children that still living here, and I know it holds a special place in their hearts too. This valley, it is special, man. It's green, and it's just wonderful. You can't find hardly another place like this on earth that I've ever seen.
Sherwood is one of 1,000 communities in the United States that was built on industry. Those towns flourished because of industry, and they withered when the industry was gone. The Gager Lime ruins are a reminder of the town's past, and in a way, they're a symbol of the thousands of other mining communities and factory towns that were once the driving force of the nation's economy. Without such reminders, how do we maintain vital connections to our past? Of course, it's impossible to save every building, every factory, every train station. As individuals, we're forced to choose daily between the things we keep and those things we toss aside. The things we keep remind us where we came from. They remind us of the values that have been passed down to us. We preserve battlefields to honor men and women of valor and dedication. What about the women and men who've worked to build families and preserve dignity through honest labor? Those who worked on the farms and at home, in the mines and on the railroads, in the schools and the factories. How will they be honored and remembered?